Welcome to a course on complex analysis. In this lecture, we are going to continue our discussions on the topic poles and residues. In this, first let us discuss about the zeros of analytic functions. Okay, first of all, before getting into this theorem and all, we'll have to see that the zeros and poles of an analytic functions are closely related. Okay. Suppose a function is analytic at a point z naught, then we can, okay, here the situation that we are talking is, suppose f is analytic at z naught, then nth derivative of f at z naught exists for all values of n. Okay, for all positive integers n, this is going to exist. Okay, sometimes your f of z naught may be equal to 0, and after your f prime at z naught may not be equal to 0. This may be the case sometimes till your not only your f but also your f prime, f double prime, all these are 0, but your f triple prime may not be equal to 0. How does it happen? Okay, this is where the concept of 0 comes in. Okay, suppose, here, suppose this is the case, then this exists for all the n. Suppose your first derivative, second derivative till mth derivative at z naught is 0, but m plus 1th derivative at z naught is not equal to 0, then f is said to have a 0 at z naught of order m. Okay, so this is what we mean to say. That for example, you may consider, I'll give you simple ideologies, simple functions. Okay, you may consider your f of z to be z power 5 multiplied with z squared minus 2. So this may be a function. This is analytic everywhere. Here, till your fifth derivative, your first derivative, second derivative, third derivative, fourth derivative, till your fifth derivative, you will have all the values to be equal to, till your fourth derivative, you will have all the values to be equal to 0 when your z is 0, but your fifth derivative and sixth derivative and seventh derivative, all other consecutive derivatives will not be equal to 0. Then we say that this function has a 0 of order 5. Okay, so I think I have made some mistake in the definition. So when we start with the original function, then we must have m minus 1 here, then we must have m here. Okay, you can consider a simple example. F of z is z to the power 4 minus z square. This is our function. What is f derivative at z? This is 4z cube minus 2z, and your second derivative is 12z squared minus 2. Okay, let us now evaluate f at 0. What is going to happen? It is 0. F prime at 0, it is again 4 times of 0 minus 2 times of 0, 0. Then your f second derivative at 0, it is going to be minus 2, which is not equal to 0. So this clearly tells us that this f has a z, 0 at z equals 0 of order 2. Okay, suppose if you have functions of whole square multiplied with z to the power 4 minus 5, if you have functions of this form, then this function has a 0 of order 2 at, okay, it has a 0 of order 2 at z equals 3. Okay, that you can very well verify. Okay, now let us see the things, right? Here I have directly given you these things. Suppose, okay, the first function, what did I choose? I chose z power 4 minus z square, right? So this may also be written as z square multiplied with z square minus 1. So this generalization is given in this theorem. This is what we are going to prove in this theorem. Now let us formally start the proof. Okay, first let us assume that f is analytic at a point z0 and it has a 0 of order m at z0 if and only if it can be written in this form, and if we can write some analytic function in this form, then we'll have, then we can prove that this function has a 0 of order m at z0. Okay, in both the parts, in both the parts, we have if a function is analytic at z naught, then it must have a Taylor series representation in powers of z minus z naught, which is valid in a neighborhood absolute of z minus z naught smaller than epsilon, which is the neighborhood of the point z naught. So this is what we have. Now let us assume f of z can be written as z minus z naught to the power m g of z holds, where g is some analytic function which is non-zero at z naught, that is g of z naught is not equal to 0 and g is analytic. So this is what we have taken. Okay, since g is also analytic at z naught, g has a Taylor series representation at or about z naught. So that is g of z shall be written as g of z naught plus g prime of z naught upon 1 factorial multiplied with z minus z naught plus z double prime of z naught upon 2 factorial multiplied with z minus z naught squared, and it goes on, right? So this is valid in some neighborhood absolute of z minus z naught less than epsilon, which is the neighborhood of the point z naught. Okay, then if we mark this as equation 1, then what happens? Then by equation 1, f of z shall be written as g of z naught multiplied with z minus z naught to the power m plus g prime of z naught upon 1 factorial multiplied with z minus z naught to the power m plus 1. Then g double prime at z naught upon 2 factorial multiplied with z minus z naught to the power m plus 2 plus etc. valid in this neighborhood. Okay. Now, what should we prove? We will have to prove f has a 0 of order m. Okay. In order to prove f has a 0 of order m, what should we do? Okay. So, that is f has a 0 of order m at z equals c0. So, this is what we should prove. What is f of z0? Since all the terms has z minus z0, this gives you, this is 0. Right? Then what is f prime of z? Your f prime of z is, since you remember that your g of z0, g prime of z0 and all other quantities are constants. So, the only terms that involve the variable is z minus z0 to the power m. That pass only involves variables. So, it is going to be m times of g of z0, z minus z0 to the power m minus 1 plus m plus 1 g prime of z0 upon 1 factorial multiplied with z minus z0 to the power m plus etc. So, if you evaluate your f prime at z0, since all the terms involves this z minus z0 term, it is 0, right? Then you go for a second derivative. So, it is m into m minus 1 into g of z0 multiplied with z minus z0 to the power m minus 2, then plus etc. Here you can very well see that all the terms will have z minus z0 to the power minimum m minus 1, then m plus 1, m plus 2, it goes that way, right? So, when you proceed, okay, here from this it is very evident that your f double prime evaluated at z0 is also 0. So, suppose let us take, we have come till m minus 1th derivative, okay? When we have come till m minus 1th derivative, we would have m into m minus 1 into till 2 we might have come, g of z0 and z minus z0 plus the other terms will be there. So, this implies m minus 1th derivative at z0 is also 0. When we go to mth derivative at z, this is going to be m factorial multiplied with z of z0 plus m plus 1 m till 2 g prime of z0 upon 1 factorial multiplied with z minus z0, and all of the terms will have z minus z0 to the power 2, 3, that kind of terms will be there, right? From this, when you try to evaluate your mth derivative at z0, you will be simply left with m factorial multiplied with g of z0. Okay, now we will have to examine what kind of value the g of z0 bears, right? So, here we have said, we have clearly told that g of z0 is not equal to 0. So, when your g of z0 cannot be equal to 0, it is very trivial that this quantity is not equal to 0. So, this proves, therefore, this proves f has a 0 of order m at z equals z0. We just proved it. Now, we'll have to prove the converse part. So, conversely, assume f has a 0 of order m at z0. Okay, then by definition, we know, actually I think I don't have to write it down. So, you know what should be proved, okay? What should we have, okay? What we have actually, that is f of z0 is 0, f prime of z0 is 0, till f m minus 1th derivative at z0 is 0, and your mth derivative of f at z0 is non-zero. So, this is what we have just by stating f as a zero of order m at z naught. Okay, after which using the analyticity, okay, that is by the analyticity, of the function f at z naught, and let us and by the definition of zero of order m we have in z minus z naught smaller than epsilon, that is in this neighborhood, f of z is summation n runs from 0 to infinity nth derivative at z naught upon n factorial multiplied with z minus z naught to the power n. Since your m, since till m minus 1th derivative we have the value to be equal to 0. So, till m minus 1th thing we have 0. Then, from mth derivative it starts. Mth derivative at z naught upon m factorial multiplied with z minus z naught to the power n. M plus 1th derivative at z naught upon m plus 1 factorial multiplied with z minus z naught to the power m plus 1, and it goes this way. Okay. So, this may be written as summation m runs from 0, okay, n runs from m to infinity, nth derivative at z naught upon n factorial multiplied with z minus z naught to the power n, right? So, this is valid in this neighborhood. Okay, now if g of z equals mth derivative at z naught upon m factorial plus m plus 1th derivative at z naught upon m plus 1 factorial multiplied with z minus z naught plus m plus 2th derivative at z naught upon m plus 2 factorial multiplied with z minus z naught whole square plus etc., then it is very obvious that your f of z can be written as z minus z naught to the power m multiplied with g of z. Okay, where, okay, now we'll have to just prove g of z naught. What is the value of g of z naught? You can very well see it is mth derivative at z naught upon m factorial. Okay, so this is not equal to 0. So this completes the proof. I thought I don't have any further pages to continue the proof, that's why I tried to combine all these things, but I have explained you all these things, but some things I might not have written down, but if you followed the lecture, you could have understood what I was trying to convey and what is done in this theorem. Okay, now let us move to some examples. Okay, we have the function f of z is z cube minus 8. So this may be written as z minus 2 multiplied with z squared plus 2z plus 4. It is very evident that f of z has a 0 of order 1, or it may be called as simple 0. As we have the term simple pole, we also have the term simple 0 at z equals 2. Okay, here your g of z is nothing but z squared plus 2z plus 4, and your z of 2 is 2 squared plus 4 plus 4, which is equal to 12, which is non-zero. right? So the theorem is verified with this. Okay, and also we say that fs is 0 of order 1, right? So what is f of 2? It is 2 cube minus 8, which is 0. And when it comes to the derivative, it is 3z squared. It has to be evaluated at the point z equals 2. So when you do so, we get 12, which is not equal to 0, which is again not equal to 0. This verifies or this validates the theorem that we have just seen. Okay, the next example is f of z equals z into e to the power z minus 1. Okay, we know e to the power z has this Taylor series expansion, which is valid in the entire complex plane. Therefore, your e to the power z minus 1 is z upon 1 factorial plus z squared upon 2 factorial plus etc. minus, actually we'll have 1 plus, and then finally we have minus 1. This is z upon 1 factorial plus z squared upon 2 factorial plus etc. Therefore, your z multiplied with e to the power z minus 1 will have z squared upon 1 factorial plus z cube upon 2 factorial plus etc. Here we can take this z squared outside. So 1 upon 1 factorial plus z upon 2 factorial plus z squared upon 3 factorial plus etc. So this is what we have. From this, we come to a conclusion that the given function f of z has a 0 of order 2 at z equals 0, with g of z equal to e to the power z minus 1 upon z whenever z is not equal to 1, and is equal to 1 when z equals, when z is not equal to 0 and when z equals 0. So this you can very well check, and your g of z equals 0, that is our z naught, right? So this is equal to 1, which is non-zero. You can very well see this is happening to be true in this case. We have few more theorems in this topic itself that we will cover in the next lecture.